Hi. So we all are aware of some of the good digital products in the Indian financial sector. We are all proud of the UPI. We are all happy how fast the real-time payment system that India developed has is working, and it's being taken to multiple countries across the globe. So, but are all the in all the banks are as digitized as we see in the payment side across the other parts? I mean, am I getting the same set of digital? Am I experiencing, or am I going to experience the same set of digitized service offerings from banks on the other side, other products areas also? Let's hear it from somebody who is an expert, who has worked across banks of in both international and international, and is a co-founder of one of the startups looking into offer bringing credit cards as a service. Joining us is Aishwarya Jaishankar, co-founder of Hyperface Technologies. Hi,
Thanks,
Aishwarya.
Prashant.
Welcome to
Thanks.
Every Day is Live India.
Thank you so much for the opportunity, Prashant. So I have been as somebody who's been in the forefront of how the API era, as I call it, has evolved it for Indian banks. I really think we are at a very exciting juncture, and it's been great to be talking at API Days now. So I will be focusing not just on the future, right? The future, I mean, we've heard enough of it, but a little bit of context and background on how API banking even came about, because banks are by nature risk-averse, by nature are animals that have to adhere to compliance. So how did they start opening up, and where are they really?
Can you share
And
your screen? Yeah, yes.
I think my screen is shared, right, Prashant?
Yeah, yes, it's there, it's there. Yes. This is good. Yeah. Over to you, Asia. Yeah.
Yeah,
I'll
a
sit back.
little bit about me. I'm a banker turned fintech entrepreneur, as Prashant told you all. I launched India's first digital savings account for a private bank. We were the first bank which rode on the eKYC that was offered along with the Aadhaar customer identity system. I also oversaw a complete bottoms-up revamp of retail banking capabilities, you know, be it digitizing the origination journeys, the servicing journeys, building interfaces which are digital native in nature, you know, not really talking to core banking legacy platforms and ISO and loading very slowly, so to put it, for the customer. So I think over the last, while I've worked for 16 years, 18 years overall, last 10, 12 years, I've been privileged to have been having a bird's eye view of how digital banking has evolved in India. I currently consult for fintechs and neobanks, and we have started with a journey to reimagine digitally bottoms-up systems through Hyperface technology. We are talking, starting with credit cards as a service, and we want to power embedded finance experiences which are futuristic. That's what I am. To quickly delve into the topic, right? Like I said, let's just take a step back and see how did these bankers who are risk-averse, who are very happy operating out of branches, really had to shake themselves and start thinking of opening up whatever their product was. While in the context of banking, we tend to bash regulators. As somebody who has observed the system, I would say that in the context of India, regulator has more often been an enabler and the person who has been nudging for things in a certain direction, which has forced banks to sort of open up in their thinking process. What do I really mean by that? Circa 2001, 2001 census of India, 35% of Indian population were actually being addressed by banks, right? Now, the government of India called this whole project financial inclusion and started making plans for it. Now, why am I going back to that? Because as part of financial inclusion, this when banks were said, please open your eyes when you're doing KYC. It doesn't have to be five different documents. It has to be one identity, one proof. So things started getting laid out for banks to start really cutting the noise and evaluating the customer for what they are. And they were forced to look at offerings which are sachetized, like a small limited service bank account. And most importantly, what financial inclusion brought about is that the need for this whole, there are many Indias, and India is what the Indians like to say, the whole rural population that was hitherto being unserviced by the typical private banks, this thing, you know, while you had a whole gamut of public banks, the service was very different from what was offered by private banks. So the regulator stepped in and said, for instance, if you want to offer so many banks in the city, you should offer so much in tier B towns and tier C towns. What it meant is a plethora of banks going out to the other Indias and starting to offer their products, and something called a business correspondence model, started evolving. Now, who is a business correspondent? A business correspondent was the representative of the bank who could go in, open the account and service for the bank's customer in the smaller locations. Now, why do I think that this is the maybe where everything began is because, like I said, from thinking inside the AC branch room, banks were forced to think for this person who's going in the sweltering heat and servicing the customers, which is where the tenets of having to share or having to open my systems to open an account and to service people started forming for banks. Obviously, we hadn't really heard of APIs yet, but what happened with VCs is an identifier that I could have an external sourcing channel and a servicing channel. The second thing that again happened with the regulatory push that I keep talking about, I'll go back to it in this conversation because those nudges has really put us where we are, honestly, was the KYC or the identification revolution. You know, we've all heard about the Aadhaar revolution. Today, India is a global model on identity, right? We take biometrics, we can pin down a customer to who he is, where he is, and his details, right? Now, this Aadhaar and central KYC registry, right, what it brought about is that a unified way of identifying the customer. Suddenly, from each bank trying to derive and evolve at a policy, they started prescribing this is what KYC is, this is what you need to take. And the authentication of Aadhaar really mitigated a lot of concerns bank had about remotely enabling a customer to open accounts, right? The regulator pushed for a product called OTP-based account opening, which is limited in nature. That is the first product. My digital savings account was also based on what it allowed the customer to do is his mobile number is seeded with Aadhaar. He provides his Aadhaar number. He receives an OTP on his mobile. And voila, his identity check is done. Now, this revolution propelled a whole lot of digital origination journeys in the country, right? Suddenly from banking means going to the bank or banking means having being ready to upload a few documents, remote biometric-based full KYC was also allowed riding on Aadhaar. So the customer information is residing in the Aadhaar repository. Banks are allowed to pull from there. And this is where API started really getting used, right? Banks started looking for identification APIs. They have plugged into the Aadhaar switch. Banks are regulatorily allowed to pull and fetch information from there and verify customers through that. So the third leg of revolution, which also led to the concept of open banking and the concept of, okay, my customer doesn't have to be in my platforms, is the evolutions around digital payments. While UPI is a success story that we have all heard, in 2003, there was a national financial switch that was set up. Every bank had to start plugging into the national financial switch. There was real-time gross settlement and national electronic fund transfer, which were introduced in 2004. Now, all this meant banks were saying, okay, I'm going to do settlements beyond the manual way. APIs and batch processing found its lingo in the operating and settlement processes. And then they set up NPCI in 2008. And I can literally say, for those of you who have been following the India story, we know that, that has been a very... what should I say? And everything sort of comes from there, right? Now, this is what regulatorily that happened, which set the founding stone. And why it is important is banks are also slow animals, okay? Unless a regulator is pushing them, I doubt if things would have happened in the pace that it is today, right? Somewhere a regulator gave the confidence to remote account open. Somewhere remote digital payments became a reality with second level of authentication. And all this sort of opened the banker's mind from traditional mindsets to say, okay, I'll start opening up my banking systems. what were the other paradigm shifts that were happening environmentally? Because at the end of the day, you're serving your customers, and when the customer evolves, his needs evolve, and you can't say I'm a dinosaur and I'll be stuck in my ways, right? At the end of the day, you're serving customers as a bank as well. A big contextual thing that happened again in India is the data revolution. For a long, long time, Indians enjoy the cheapest data plans, right? Which meant a boom in smartphones. Smartphones were available for as little as 100 USD, right? And mobile applications were reality. Everyone was downloading Amazon and the local players, which led to the second part, which is e-commerce, right? We had local Flipkart today is acquired by Walmart. We had Amazon coming in. Now, suddenly, you have a phone in your hand. You have a data plan you want to play. You want to pay, right? How do I pay? That is when the UPI, the digital payments converged here. We had wallet players who came in first before UPI to offer seamless payments, right? So conceptually, what happened here? For a customer, interacting with a bank was going to an ATM or doing a fund transfer at best from his own banking application or internet banking. He moved from thinking that bank is my point of code to third-party applications is where I could handle my money as well. Now, today, this thought process has been taken much further ahead by a UPI, which processes over 90% of its transactions through non-banking applications. GPay, PhonePay, all those offerings actually do much more than banks. While the underlying account needs to be a bank account, the actual processing or distribution of the transaction is happening over the third-party application. So contextually, what did all this mean for the banks? You know, let's come back to bankers that everyone likes to bash, right? Banking systems are monolithic, okay? They are meant to do few things. They are meant to do it really well in a most resilient manner. I do not want to sort of give you a very, very complex picture, but if I were to sum up, right, there needs to be something to manage the identification of the customer. Because again, regulator in India demands that you have an universal ID. A bank cannot say, I don't know if a customer has a credit card with me or a brokerage account with me. A bank is supposed to have a trace of customer level product holdings, and customer level identification needs to be managed, which meant banks needs a system for it. The second system that banks inevitably need is the transaction processing layer. In a liability side, it could be a Finacle. On a credit card side, it could be a Vision Plus. So what does the core banking layer do? Basically authorize the transaction. If there is a ledger to be managed, manage it. And then you have a CMS system which processes card transaction. You have an FRM system which ensures that the transaction is routed within your risk policies and so on and so forth. So this, I would say, forms the heart of the engine. But the third thing which was as important for banks to deliver service to the customers were the customer-facing channels. I mean, believe it, once upon a time, internet banking was called as an electronic banking channel. And call center was the bigger channel. So you had to think of how do I give the customer, for instance, if he wants to block a credit card, if he wants to request for a new PIN, most likely the contact center was the port for service delivery. The second large piece where banks made money was cross-sell, which meant you had to invest in data platforms, you had to invest in marketing tools. So these are all monoliths, okay? All these systems I'm talking about, be it a data warehouse that a bank deploys or be it a contact center software, they do not think of an age where customer could be omni-channel, right? So these monolithic systems were not really ready. If we go back to the customer expectation evolution, right? There was a large mismatch. And I have been at the thick of things where we know that this is not the experience that customer wants, which means there was no choice but to upgrade and offer what the customer is demanding. So what did customer evolution mean for banking? Customers moved from waiting for things to happen to real-time interactions. Imagine telling a customer who is dealing with the state-of-the-art e-commerce apps that your request has been noted down. Please wait for 2 working days for it to be resolved. It was simply not possible. Customer wanted real-time service resolutions. Customer wanted cross-sell to happen right there. He was ready to click a button. Why wasn't the bank ready to offer him a journey to do that? Which is when banks sort of opened their minds from saying, okay, these are the monolithic components I have. This is how they function too. This is how I need to make them function. I call it the evolution of electronic channels into customer interfaces. The moment banks started thinking interfaces, APIs became inevitable, right? The first wave of APIs, which all of us have seen, is we have actually done a data table and offered it as an API. Things were not real time. In the back end, it might still be a downloadable Excel that the operation person was downloading and putting it into the batch file of the respective core banking application. So that is how the digitization started, right? Be it back end processes, be it cross-sell journeys. But like I said, the customer kept pushing for real time interactions. What did this mean for banks, right? We had to actually build digital maturity. We had to actually upgrade the core system to be able to absorb APIs. It wasn't enough that we had middleware layers to issue an API and allow backend processing, which was slower and clunky, right? So this is what, I wouldn't say every bank today is there, but every bank which is customer facing, the need of the hour is either they are doing all of this, some of this, or at least they have started with an account opening API and a mobile application, right? Today, when you look at what the bank's digital teams are doing, is like I said, multiple banks are in multiple stages of digital maturity. But the realization that has happened is account opening APIs are still simple. They sit out of the system. They only talk to the customer identification platform. What more can I give the customer? That's why you're seeing banks today competing with mobile applications offering 100 plus functionalities. That has become the new normal, especially in the pandemic. The good thing for all of us who have been proponents of digitization is that there hasn't really been any other mechanism. No bank today has the luxury to tell the customer to go to the branch. Everything has moved to digital, which meant you had to have interfaces. You need to have solutions that think customer first and digital first, right? The other challenge that came along with it in the API journey is, which journey should I prioritize, right? The account opening one is a no-brainer. I get incremental customer, but do I prioritize a servicing journey or do I prioritize a feature in my mobile banking? For instance, if the customer is saying, I'm going to block PIN versus you wanting to offer a UPI or a eNACH view functionality. These were all the real questions that banks started answering. And like I said, depending on the evolution that they are, some banks are still finding answers, right? The second thing, like I said, is core systems started getting upgraded. They are still monoliths, but they are compatible to building APIs on top of them. And again, this is where the word of fintech and fintechs having an entry started coming in, because there were fintechs which were solving this problem of building APIs. Very simple example of is UPI, right? UPI is nothing but, if you think of it, it is at its heart open banking. Right, all banks connect to the NPCI switch and they are assigned the same set of API parameters that they need to adhere to. Right, now this is not something every core system was capable of. There were vendors, there are still vendors who do this for 14 banks, 15 banks. Another big example is bill payments. So this is where entry of fintech started happening, right? Now, today, if you look at what banks are doing, they're actually, like I said, investing in core systems that are much more compatible on API. The last thing that new age banks absolutely need is artificial intelligence and big data, right? Be it a Hadoop or any such big data deployment is not unheard of in today's age for retail banks. I would say it has moved from a cute thing to necessity. And I've seen this evolution. 5 years back in a bank room, you said chatbot, nice to have. Today, chatbot is inevitable if you're thinking of how do I reduce costs. There is MarTech tools, right? How do I real-time engage with a customer? The way Amazon tells you, hey, you have left 3 items on your checkout. Imagine your bank doing that. And trust me, there are banks that have begun doing that also. So this is the whole gamut of what banks are doing to sort of get into digital maturity when it comes to APIs. What does the future look like, right? I mean, it's all exciting. But like I said, bank applications today accept the reality that there are going to be multiple APIs talking back to them. Let's take a simple example of a CMS, right? A CMS will need to talk to the core liability application in terms of the GL positioning end of day. Earlier, it used to happen over a ledger and a report and a batch. Now it happens over APIs. It needs to talk to the loan origination or the LMS systems of the bank. Again, banks invest in a separate LMS system because that is not the capability of a CMS. The KYC and identifier system today talks over APIs. You have your CRM, you have your FRM, you have third-party digital marketplaces coming in, your SMS gateways. So basically, what this is also loving to do is a whole lot of unbundling. You know, if earlier terms like fintechs were unheard of, today fintech has evolved to regtech and lending tech, right? Last 5 years has seen a rapid evolution somewhere also because of this ability to unbundle. Instead of being monoliths, they are now embracing modularity, right? That is the new reality of banking and APIs, where systems are modularized, where APIs are plug and play, and solutions are not thought of as a linear journeys, but journeys that absorb data from third-party API or even external APIs, right? And data security, everything has been evolving. I'm consciously not touching on the data security risk part because as a banker, I know compliance and risk regulations are something that you need to adhere to. You always build solutions around that, right? Apart from that, assuming it's a given, this is how the future of bank interfaces looks like and is going towards. I mean, this exact diagram is also a PwC representation. I put the source credit there. Now, what is next? You know, this is all very interesting. Like I said, a lot of banks have gone to the from saying what is an API, they've built APIs, they're now talking about the third stage in my mind for banks is what does it mean? Once you've reached a certain level of digital maturity, what do you start doing with it? The first step is monetize, right? I mean, once I've gone beyond hygiene and I have a fantastic set of APIs, banks are now reevaluating fintech partnerships. Banking is finding a big in. Earlier, the banker thinking was, I want my customer to come to me. Banks are now accepting that I can innovate better and make money if I open up my API to partners, which is happening. The API banking heads of bank, whether you believe it or not, there are banks in India who already have API bank heads and evolved set of API suites, sandboxes, which you can go and request access and start working on. And all this is also leading to a lot of revenue, incremental revenue for banks. Right?
The second part
of monetization is also cost savings. Imagine a simple chatbot. What is the cost saving that it can bring on the processing side in terms of number of people? Your reset pin or your request a new pin, which is happening digitally. I don't need to send an envelope and a pin to the customer. Customer can reset it on the mobile app. The amount of cost savings there is unimaginable. And that's something that banks have actively started looking for. The other thing with API banking is innovation, right? I'm sure you've all heard about India's open banking platform that all of us are excited about, which is Sahamati Account Aggregator Platform. We really believe that this could be the next, UPI equivalent in terms of revolutionizing the way we have been offering banking and banking products. This will allow for a bank also is an opportunity, right? Right now, I knew Aishwarya as a customer who was doing XYZ transactions with me. When it came to credit,
last couple of seconds. Can you quickly wrap up the time check?
Yeah, sure.
We are nearing 25 minutes. Sure.
I'm in the last slide, actually. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
Now, the third thing that is happening collaboration, banks are moving to sell to travel loans at a travel portal and FDs and wealth tech applications. We're all hoping that all this would mean some great things to the customers in terms of segmented offerings, financial super apps, contextual banking, and whatnot. So I would say the future of API banking looks bright and shining for India. Thanks again for the opportunity, Prashant.
Thanks, Aishwarya. I just hope that now, since you are on the other side of the table, you are getting to see some real challenges from a different perspective, right? hope the banks are opening up their data, the information that you are looking for in terms of bringing up with your offering in the fintech.
Yeah. Prashant, I would say the paranoia is coming down, right? Like I said, I'm somebody in the evolution for 15 years, so it looks very positive for me. You know, when you are going to interact with the bank today, I can understand how the bankers come across to you. I know the context. I know that they were happy sitting and doing entries end of day on Excel, right? So I would say there's been a massive evolution and opening up. Senior people in banks are now saying, tell me if there is any partnership opportunity with fintech. We have these APIs. We think something can be done. I would say it's going in a positive direction, Prashant.
Great. Thanks a lot. And thanks a lot for joining us here at API Days Live India. And wish you all the best with your venture.
Thanks, Prashant. Thank you so much.
Thank you.